Episode 2 introduced us to Overlord's core cast of characters, but what we didn't see in the anime was a specific focus on one of them more than the others. While we did get the general idea of what each of these four guardians were like, there was actually quite a bit more to Demiurge's encounters. A series of interactions involving him and a few other characters that marked the origins of some very twisted developments from later on in the story. So, let's continue with this Overlord cut content series and take a look at everything that we missed from this episode. But first, this video is sponsored by Surfshark, my personal go-to VPN for securing my online browsing experience. With over 3,200 servers in 65 different countries, Surfshark can open up a whole new collection of easily accessible and streamable anime. Whether it be the Muse Asia anime collection on YouTube, or the vastly larger collection of region-locked anime on Netflix, Surfshark will allow you to access all of it. So, if you use surfshark.deal/anynews, you can get 83% off a 2-year plan, plus an additional 3 free months, all for a very affordable price. What I personally find makes Surfshark so great is the fact that only one subscription is needed. A single account can be carried across any number of devices and apps all at the same time. There's also a strict guarantee that no data logs will be kept across any of them. If you wanted an even deeper layer of security though, there's numerous other features that can help to encrypt your data with industry-leading technology. So, if you're interested in gaining access to this more secure and versatile online experience, then go ahead and use the link in the description to check out surfshark.deal/anynews. Now, let's get back to the video. Episode 2, Floor Guardians, covering chapters 2-3 of the light novel. With Xiaotier being the first of the Floor Guardians to make their appearance, it's here that we're given an introduction to her lustful personality, an aspect of her design that could easily be explained by the tendencies of her creator. It was only just speculation on Ainz's part, but he wasn't at all surprised that a guildmate whose catchphrase was literally "porn games are my life" would make such a character. So he definitely didn't put it past Peroncino to fill her bio with all sorts of X-rated video game character traits. The next to appear after Xiaotier was the guardian with the highest weapon-based attack power in all of Nazarick, the sovereign of the frozen river Cocytus. Then shortly after him was the creator of the Inferno Demiurge and the captain of all the others, Albedo. Now, unlike in the anime, Demiurge had actually taken a moment to point out that there were still a few people missing. Aside from the two other floor guardians whose presence wasn't necessary, the Prince of Fear along with Crimson, Grant, and all the other domain guardians were absent as well. As for what these domain guardians are, well, these were the second of the two types of guardians that existed within Nazarick. The first was of course the floor guardians, powerful NPCs who were in charge of defending one or more levels of the tomb. That being the case, domain guardians were then more like subordinates who only guarded a single part of a level. So rather than report directly to Ainz, instead these area guardians reported to their respective floor guardian, making it the floor guardian's job to relay any important information back to them. In any case, the first order of business was to discuss Nazarick's precarious situation. One by one, each guardian went on to report the lack of any strange occurrences during the time of their teleportation. Since the 4th and 8th floor guardians weren't there though, Albedo had volunteered to investigate those floors on her own. It was an offer that Ainz had readily accepted, but not before first cautioning her to be very careful on the 8th. To put it in his own exact words, he said that if something happened there, it's possible that she may not be able to deal with it. So if that's the warning that Ainz is giving to one of the strongest beings in Nazarick, then it kind of makes you wonder what exactly it is that awaits any person unfortunate enough to make it there. Now, it's after this that Ainz briefly discusses the hierarchy of power within Nazarick. I know I've gone through it many times before, but allow me to reiterate it one more time for any new people. As explained by Ainz himself, there were only 4 NPCs in Nazarick who possessed absolute superiority in their respective fields of combat. Cocytus had the highest attack power when armed, Albedo possessed the highest defenses in general, and Sibas was the most proficient in combat, especially when in his true form. But despite the triangular dynamic that these three shared, the one that stood above all of them was Xiaotier. She alone was an unstoppable force that none of the others could handle by themselves. Shifting over towards the logistical side of Nazarick, it was clear to Ainz that a better system of sharing information was needed now. So, in order to make that happen, Ainz had placed both Demiurge and Albedo in charge of implementing it. What's interesting to note about this order though is that, once again the 8th floor was kept exempt from it. In fact, the time it took Ainz to consider the 8th floor's position in the overall plan resulted in him deciding to revoke Albedo's initial order to investigate it. As of now, The 8th floor was off limits to anyone who didn't have express permission to enter it, permission that could only be granted by Aynes. As for the 7th, 9th, and 10th floors, well, Aynes went on to order the removal of the seals that prohibited the lesser minions from traveling between them. A decision that not only shocked both Demiurge and Albedo, but also highlighted just how serious the situation was. The reason why this is because minions weren't the same as the guild created NPCs. They were simply mobs and monsters that automatically spawned here, a very basic line of defense that came with the tomb itself. So, to let such inferior creatures walk around in the same space as that of the supreme beings, well, that was something that just didn't sit right with Demiurge or Albedo. Now, after Aynes had left, the reason the Guardians were so enamored by his presence was mainly because of the despair aura that he emitted while around them. Normally, this type of skill wouldn't have had an effect on any of them. But because Aynes was holding the staff of Aynes Ulgon, the buff he received from it was enough to inflict the fear status on all of them. That's why every single one of them had kept themselves in a submissive position all the way to the end. They couldn't even dare to stand up and face the overwhelming power in front of them. Moving on to Demiurge's discussion with Mare, there was a little bit more to his fascination with breeding than what we saw in the anime. Yes, he was curious to see who would be the best in terms of making an heir for Aynes, but that wasn't the only option for when it came to increasing Nazareth's forces. There were a few other candidates Demiurge could think of that could potentially be useful in a set of breeding experiments, Mare included. So, since this was something that Demiurge had taken an interest in, he literally asked Mare if he wanted to try making some babies. There wasn't anyone in the tomb that he could do it with, but there was always the possibility that there could be someone from outside the tomb. Perhaps a human, dark elf, or any other closely related species. Of course, Mare didn't yet fully understand what Demiurge meant by this, but if it meant that he could be useful to Aynes, then he was more than happy to do whatever Demiurge asked of him. That said, Demiurge knew that such a project would require some serious preparations. Not only would the increase in population result in a higher upkeep cost for the tomb, but any mistake would result in a scolding from Aynes himself, a punishment that Demiurge would do anything to prevent from happening. So, rather than take the risk of bringing more people into Nazareth, Demiurge planned to instead bring any and all captured subjects to a ranch outside of Nazareth, a place independent from the tomb in which any and all experiments could be handled by him alone. Switching things back to Aynes, the room we find himself in next was none other than his own private quarters, a very messy space in which numerous items, weapons, and armor were scattered all over the place. The reason why this is because an infinite number of items were allowed to be crafted via Yggdrasil's data crystals, a common item that was dropped whenever a monster was defeated. So, since data crystals were quite the abundant resource, players could create as many items as they wanted, often choosing to stock up on the ones that they liked the most. And since Aynes was definitely no exception to this, his room was filled with all sorts of high-level equipment that he didn't even need, a lot of which he couldn't even use due to his caster form. He was able to pick them up due to the amount of physical ability points he'd amassed, but using them in combat was a totally separate issue. Holding a giant broadsword wasn't the same thing as being proficient with it. No, that was determined by the user's class. Now, as Aynes began to contemplate his new existence, he was able to come up with a reasonable hypothesis towards his uncanny mental stability. He thought that perhaps his newly found level-headedness was a result of his undead resistances, one of which was a perfect defense against any and all sorts of psychic attacks. This was just a bit of speculation, but it did make quite a lot of sense since his new existence was an undead body and mind with the vestiges of a human clinging to it. That being the case, the mental suppression that happens whenever he overreacts to something could very well just be his undead mind reacting to an abnormal occurrence for the undead species. Whatever it was, it didn't really bother him since his free will was still intact. What did bother him, though, was the constant fatigue that came from maintaining this grand overlord appearance. You see, for the past 2 days, Aynes wasn't left to himself even once. He was either being followed around by an entourage of guards or constantly being attended to by a group of beautiful maids. At first, it wasn't really all that bad, but eventually it just became annoying and tiresome. So, that's why he refused any company when it came time to leave his chambers. As we saw, though, whatever brief moment of solitude he initially had was quickly interrupted by Demiurge and his group of demons. While Demiurge was able to deduce that this stranger was Momonga because of his use of teleportation, the other demons were able to do so a different way. What the anime had failed to mention here was that every minion, NPC, and supreme being of Nazareth emitted a distinct signal that dictated whether they were an ally or not. and usually the stronger that signal was, the higher the rank the person emitting it was. So, for someone like Ainz, the signal he emitted was something so radiant and bright that not only could it easily be distinguished from all the others, but it could also be detected from a significant distance. That's how Demiurge's evil lords were able to immediately know that the person in front of them was Momonga. Now, shortly after Momonga had left with Demiurge, the evil lords were met by another guest. A signal they recognized to be one of the Floor Guardians, but weren't entirely sure who it was until she showed her face. As it turns out, it was none other than Albedo, as she was in the process of searching for Demiurge. Since Demiurge was nowhere to be seen though, she immediately turned to the demons and asked for his whereabouts, a question that had placed the demons in a particularly tricky situation. On one hand, they'd been ordered to refer to Momonga as Dark Warrior, but on the other, here was Albedo not knowing that this Dark Warrior was Momonga. So when Albedo inquired as to who this Dark Warrior was and why Demiurge would be accompanying him, the demons weren't entirely sure how to answer. They hesitated as Albedo continued to grow more anxious, making it painfully obvious that there was something they were hiding. As soon as that point had become clear, one single warning was all that was needed to make them explain that this Dark Warrior was Momonga. Had they avoided the question any further, then death would have been a likely punishment. Now, one thing to note about this scene is that 18 hours had passed since the last time Albedo had seen Momonga, so she was neither physically nor mentally prepared to meet him. Her hair was a mess, her clothes were dirty, and even her wings looked a little bit tattered. That's not to say that it affected her overall appearance, but it simply wasn't an image that she was prepared to present Momonga with, especially since to her it had been such a long time since the last time she saw him. As she ordered the demons to prepare a bath and fetch her clothes, they actually had a suggestion of their own in mind. They thought that rather than spend all this time getting ready and potentially miss Momonga, perhaps it would be better to show up as is and showcase all the hard work she'd been doing. Since her beauty wasn't ruined at all in any way, there wasn't really any reason to prepare herself the way that she wanted. So, despite this being such an outlandish suggestion, Albedo did agree that this may actually be the best course of action. She just needed to verify that this would in fact get her on Momonga's good side. This wasn't really that important of a scene overall, but it does explain how Albedo knew where to find Momonga towards the end of the episode. In any case, it was while all of that was happening that Ainz was in awe over the clear night sky that he'd never seen before. Because the previous home of Nazarick was a dark, cold place known as Helheim, the only thing he'd ever see in-game was a dark, clouded night that lasted forever. Then, since his real-world home wasn't that much different, this was the first time in which he could truly look up to the sky and see it as it was supposed to be seen. As he was about to cast a spell to enable flight, he quickly realized that his armor wouldn't let him. Yes, there was a skill that enabled magic users to cast spells while in it, but that wasn't a skill that he had learned how to use. So, with only 5 spells being currently available to him, any others would require certain items or charms in order to be cast. That's why we see him use the birdwing charm in order to fly. The instant he got up into the air, memories of his old guildmate flooded into his mind as he remembered how much he would have loved to see this. The reason Blue Planet had even started playing Yggdrasil in the first place was mainly to experience sceneries like this that were no longer available in the real world. It was a fascination with nature that went so deep that most of his time in-game was spent recreating the night sky on the 6th floor of Nazarick. This was the ideal world that Blue Planet had envisioned and come to realize in the game of Yggdrasil, a world that Ainz wished he could see right now. Now, when Demiurge had come to interrupt this sentiment, there was actually a brief moment in which Ainz had become frustrated with him. This sudden outburst had made him feel as if his precious memories were being trampled on, especially since they went to imply something as childish as world domination. Though Ainz decided to play along with it as a joke, Demiurge on the other hand went to perceive it differently. And because Ainz was so enthralled with the sight in front of him, not once did he turn around to see that Demiurge actually believed him to be serious. Had it been anyone but the smartest being in Nazarick, then he definitely would have made sure to clarify that he was joking. But because this was the ever-insightful Demiurge, Ainz truly believed that he would understand his true intent, thus marking the beginning of a long downward spiral of even more misunderstandings. Now, one last thing that wasn't really mentioned towards the end of the episode was the level of caution Ainz felt was needed when it came to concealing Nazarick. Because the process was clearly going to take several more hours, an early warning system was set in place to detect any sentient being that came too close. It was a minion-based detection system that would instantly alert Demiurge should anything come within a 3-mile radius. Despite this being extremely discreet though, I still felt that another system without the minions was also needed, sort of like an extra precaution should anything slip through the gaps. The reason why he wanted to be so careful was mainly because he wasn't sure how strong the people of this world was. If there was even the possibility that any outsider could be over level 100, then their best defense against that would be through concealment. That was the only surefire way that a potentially fatal conflict could be avoided. But yeah, that's pretty much it for what we missed from episode 2. There wasn't anything entirely crucial to the overall plot, but there were a few subtle details that further developed a few of the Floor Guardians. So if you liked what you saw here, then be sure to leave a like and comment to let me know. I'll try to get the next episode out sometime next month. Until then though, feel free to check out any of the Tencent videos that will soon be flooding this channel. Now, before I go, I'd like to thank Surfshark once again for sponsoring this video. If you're interested in a more secure and versatile online experience, then be sure to use surfshark.deal/annienews to get 83% off that 2-year plan today. Now, as always, thank you so much for watching, and if you enjoyed this type of anime content, then you already know what to do. So, until next time, ciao!